Are there any more boys and girls that want to come down and join us this morning? Can y'all say good morning really loud? All right. I'm going to do a little review from last week. Do y'all remember the verse that we had?
Whatever we
do it for the Lord and not for men. Good job. All right. Have you ever lost anything? Have you ever lost anything? Yeah, of course you have. Now, we all have done that, haven't we? All right, what do we do when we misplace something? We retrace our steps and we go back to try to find it, don't we? All right, today we're going to talk about some parents. Listen to this, guys. Some parents that lost their son. Do you know who? Y'all listen to me. Look at me. Do you know who those parents were? Mary and Joseph. You know who Mary and Joseph lost? Who did they lose? They lost Jesus. They lost Jesus. All right. Now, so I want you to listen really quiet. I got a surprise for you. I want you to listen really quietly about my story about Mary and Joseph and when they lost Jesus. All right. Every year, Jesus and his parents went to Jerusalem for Passover. One year, when Jesus was only 12 years old, Joseph said,
"Let's go to Jerusalem, Mary. It's time for the Passover feast."
And Jesus was excited and said,
"Yeah, I'm ready."
He sounds excited, didn't he? All right, the Passover was really a really big holiday that was celebrated in Jerusalem. Everyone in the whole country would come to it. People would travel for days After the feast was over, Mary and Joseph began stayed in Jerusalem. But Mary and Joseph didn't know that he was that they lost him. Or family members or friends. Listen, guys. After a while, Mary looked at Joseph and said,
"Have you seen Jesus?"
And Joseph said back,
"No, he must be with some friends or family. He's fine. You know how he likes to stop and talk to people."
They kept walking. Mary and Joseph kept walking. After a while, they still hadn't seen Jesus. So they began to ask around to some family and friends.
"Have you seen Jesus? Anyone?"
And Joseph said,
"Oh, that boy. We better retrace our steps back to Jerusalem."
"What else is that boy going to do to worry me?"
"Don't worry. We will find him."
So after 3 days, they found him. He was sitting with the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. When his parents saw him, they were thrilled. His mother said to him,
"Son, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been so worried looking for you."
"Why were you looking for me?"
Jesus asked his mom,
"Didn't you know I would be in my father's house?"
Right, guys. See, Jesus knew at a young age that God had a plan for him. God is Jesus' heavenly father. Guess what, guys? Look at me. He's our heavenly father, too. Joseph was Jesus' earthly father, but God was his heavenly father. God is our heavenly father, and this church, guys, listen. This church is our father's house. Can y'all say that? Father's house. This church is our father's house. Sometimes we get so busy in our lives that we lose Jesus ourselves. Did you know that? Do you know how we get so busy that we lose Jesus? We get so busy at school and doing other things that we lose Jesus. But do you know where we can find Jesus? In our Father's house. That's right, our church, our Father's house. So we can retrace our steps back when we lose Jesus, and he is right here all the time. Now, our Father's house is a place of worship. Listen to this. A place of worship and a house of prayer, a house of peace, love, joy, and fellowship. What better place could we be than in our Father's house? Okay. He's going to come and pray for us.
Our Heavenly Father, thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you for this church and this church family together. And thank you for these children, Lord. Help us to raise them to live for you, Lord. Be with Brother Don as he brings the message that I'm sure we all stand in need of, Lord, for some new subjects in our pride. Amen.
Good morning again. All right, if you would, we'll go ahead and stand. We'll start with our service. And this song actually kind of goes along in the Thank you.
Your Savior wants to find me, because that's what my heart will do. Here in the sanctuary, in the fellowship hall, are joining us online.
And we are continuing to grow online in our congregation, all the way from Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, to Washington State, New York State, Pennsylvania, and places beyond. So wherever you're from, whether you're from Ireland, or land of Israel, or wherever you're from, we're thankful that you're with us. Join us for this worship experience in the Lord. I want to start with our Carman kids this morning. We got a beautiful picture of a beautiful young lady, Grace Tabor. Beautiful little Grace, parents of Tom and Pam Tabor. Grace loves her mama and daddy and enjoys spending time with family and friends. She loves dogs, especially her doggies, Bear and Socko. Her favorite foods are chicken nuggets, french fries, honey buns, tomatoes, and watermelon. Boy, that's a variety, isn't it? Amen. So while we're talking about the kids in our church, I got a card here with some flowers that were sent. It said, "For Ellie, Carman Kids." And then I got a handmade thank you note. I thought this was real sweet. I just wanted to check this. Thank you for sending us love and prayer in our time of loss. And thank you for the stuff. And love, Ellen and Levi Clark. And this was them passing up there. But anyway, we appreciate it. Also, on behalf of the Dunleavy family, let me express appreciation for your prayers and your everything you did for them, the food and everything that was done on their behalf this week. All right, let's see. Other announcements. Tonight, 6 o'clock, we got Sunday evening worship at service. We encourage you to be present this evening at 6 p.m. Bring the kids and come for the Sunday evening service here at 6 o'clock. On Wednesday evening, we got adult Bible study at 6 p.m. We got youth at 6 p.m. and Awana. And in the bulletin today, there's an announcement regarding the Awana from 6 to 7, and then music. Anybody wants to stay, can stay. They do music from 7 until about 7:30. So even the white kids, adult kids, big kids, park, or whatever, just come on in the sanctuary on Wednesday evening at following the 7 o'clock dismissal from the Awana and the youth and the adults, and spend some time in music. Also got a pantry drive for the Awana. And it tells you the things that are needed in the bulletin today. Okay, sign up, Tim, Jeremy Tim, sign up at National Day of Prayer, May the 6th. Parsons Elementary School at 8 a.m., the Cable Elementary School at 8 a.m., the Care Tennessee County Middle School at 9:30, and Riverside High School at 9:30 a.m. That's on May 6th, National Day of Prayer. And you're invited to come and attend that with us. Wedding chair for C.J. Whitfield and Yvonne Wilson on May the 8th from 10:30 until 12:30 at the front of the church. And as far as I know, these are my announcements for today. And again, we welcome you to Carman Baptist Church, Darby, Tennessee.
All right, we'll stand and continue with our songs for this day. There's a lot to
every building in the temple of praise. power.
Okay. This is our auditorium. So, we'll just play for the offering this morning. This is not just a time for an offering. We've got a fire that's on the ark. This is the time of year to do it. It's coming to all of us. So, we pray. So, we want you to pray for us today. Joel, can you do this?
Yeah. see the power and presence and the evidence of the Lord all over my life. Amen to that, brother. I think we can all who've experienced the grace of God give that kind of a vivid testimony of the power and presence of God. Not just once a year or twice a year at Christmas or Easter, but every single day that we live. God is good every day, all day. God is good.
Amen.
Got your Bible handy? Won't you take them with me, please, and go to the book of Philippians. And I'm going to preach this morning on a subject that I feel led to entitle The Threefold Secret of a Successful Life. A Threefold Secret of a Successful Life. And unlike so many folks of this world, I'm going to tell you where this comes from. It comes from the heart of a man who's in jail. You say, boy, that's a strange thing here, preacher. Here you are. You want to talk to me and preach to me about a man that's in jail? Yeah, I do. I want to share with you something that comes from the heart of a man who's in jail. In fact, he's in jail writing letters. Writing letters. He writes four books. They're called prison epistles. And this is one of the book to the church at from Philippi. To the Philippian jailer, to the Philippian church. The book of Philippians. And in this particular passage of scripture that we're about to read from, in Philippians chapter 3, he pours his heart out and gives us a key to his successful life. And as far as I'm concerned, he's one of the most successful Christians that ever lived. His name is the Apostle Paul. When it comes to New Testament individuals, New Testament personalities, the Apostle Paul is second only to the Lord Jesus Christ. He certainly was not perfect, and we're going to look at the imperfection of his life. Though there was a time in his life when he thought he was, and boy, he thought he had trained it. And then he realized, no, he met Jesus, and it all changed. In fact, he really wanted to, if he could, he would like to escape from the reputation of his past and just flush it all down the drain. He kind of uses that language here in the text. So let's read about it. Threefold secrets of a great life. Let's begin, however, in verse 1 of Philippians chapter 3. To see what how this man used to be. I mean, what he attained, but it wasn't success. It was worldly stuff. I mean, he gained the world. He gained prestige and significance. He had a religion that was of his head. He had things in this world that was of his head. One day he really met Jesus, and man, what a difference it made in his heart, in his life. It changed his heart. Philippians chapter 3, beginning in verse 1, finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same thing unto you, to me indeed, it's not grievous, but for you it is safe. Beware of dogs. Beware of evil workers. Beware of contagion. Boy, that sounds strange, doesn't it? Beware of dogs. You didn't like dogs. Dogs are scavengers. They were then, they are now. Now, that doesn't include Bonnie who's outside. I mean, she's one of the most faithful Baptists that we've got. She's an honorary member of Corinth Baptist Church. And it's that time has been bestowed upon her by the pastor because she's here Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. I wish every Baptist would practice that. Amen? Wish everyone would practice. Beware of dogs. He's talking about the Judaizers that followed the Apostle Paul around everywhere he went. And they tried to say things like this. He's really not an apostle. And he really doesn't have the power of God over him. And he really's not telling you the right thing. You need to listen to us. We are it, and he ain't it. Well, he went through the suffering to prove he was it. He went through the shipwreck. He went through the privation. He went through the beatings. And survived every bit of it, and they had suffered none of it. I don't blame him for calling the dog concealed. Evil workers, that's what he says here in verse 2. They're evil. Anybody who wants to tear down the things of God is an evil worker. In fact, there's going to be the most evil worker that's ever been on the face of the earth. The man of sin is going to be revealed. The son of perdition is going to be revealed. And I think he's already been born and living. Sometimes I wonder if he's not running our country. But anyway. Beware of dogs, beware of evil workers, beware of concision. For we are the circumcision, the Jews which worship God in the Spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the flesh. Though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man think that he hath whereof he might trust in the flesh, he said, I more. I was circumcised the eighth day of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, of the Hebrew, of the Hebrew. As touching the law, he said, I was a Pharisee. Concerning zeal, persecuting the church, touching the righteous, which is in the law, blameless. But notice this. This was a failure of life. He tried to go to heaven by keeping the law. It did not work. It didn't work then. It don't work now. If you're going to try to keep the law and keep all the laws, make sure that your boys, whenever they're born, they're circumcised on the eighth day. In fact, taken to the temple in Jerusalem and let the priest do it. Can't do it. Temple ain't there. The law has been fulfilled in Jesus. It was nailed to the cross.
Amen.
Before the Apostle Paul got saved, he thought, boy, I can work and work and work and work, and I can get so good and so much gooder than I'm good. He said, God will smile favorably one day upon me. He thought it was his religious duty to go and persecute Christians and put them to death. Folks, one day he met Jesus and realized that don't get it. Look at the seventh verse. For what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and then count them all dung, that I may win Christ and be found in Him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith in Christ, the righteousness which is of God. By faith. How do you say, by grace through faith? Who wrote it? The Apostle Paul, the guy that's writing this. How do you say, by grace through faith? Look at verse 10. Man, what a tremendous thing. Philippians 3, verse 10. That I may know Him, that I may know Christ. And the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His suffering. They made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain of the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I'd already attained, either were already perfect. But I fall after that if I may apprehend that for which I am apprehended for Christ Jesus. And here it is. Three steps to a successful life. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting of those things which are behind and reaching forth to those things which are before, I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ. Therefore, that is therefore, as many as be perfect. Now, it doesn't mean sinners who are perfect, because you ain't going to get sinners who are perfect down here. If you tell me that you can live without sin, I'm going to tell you the Bible calls you a liar. Book of 1 John proves me so. What that word means is spiritually mature. You will be perfect one day when you leave this earthly house and this earthly tabernacle and this earthly body behind. And you rise up to meet the Lord in the clouds. You'll have a resurrected body or a transformed body that will be changed like the glorious resurrected body of Jesus Christ. You will live in a perfect world. You'll dwell eternally. experience perfection, but not until then, don't fool yourself. You're just too kind of folks in the world. Saved folks and lost folks. And if you live and gain the whole world of doubt that Jesus died lost, you will have lost everything and been one of the most foolish people that ever lived on the face of the earth. He finished the verse. Let's be thus minded. If anything you be otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. What are the three steps of his successful life revealed to us in the 13th and 14th verses? He said, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth out of those things that are before, I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Who is Gotham today? Who's this guy sitting in a Roman prison cell waiting his execution that you were saying was one of the most successful people that ever lived on the face of the earth? Oh yeah, it's the Apostle Paul. He walked more miles. He preached more sermons. He traveled more countries. He started more churches than any other person that I've ever known anything about. He was sold out to the devil. Religiously, he was sold out to the devil before he met Jesus. But he had a transforming experience with a risen, resurrected, living Lord Jesus. On the road to Damascus, with a letter of pardon in his back pocket to bring Christians back to Jerusalem, put them on trial, and put them to death. But when he met Jesus, he was called Saul, then Saul of Tarsus, born in Tarsus, raised in Jerusalem. A very educated man. Intellectual. He was an intellectual giant. He had literally sat at the feet of Gamaliel, the doctor of the law, a doctor of the Old Testament, the most learned professor of his day, had learned the Old Testament scriptures. But his religion got out of his head, got down in his heart when he met Jesus in a transforming experience on the Damascus Road. This man is never the same again. This guy who had given his consent at the stoning of Stephen, one of the first seven deacons of the early New Testament church, he had the authority to stop him, but he didn't. Had made him an accessory to murder. He was guilty of murder. He had murder in his heart. He had a Roman legion traveling with him wherever he went to bring Christians to put them in bonds and chains and bring them down for trial and for death. This murderer became a missionary transformed by the power of the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ. Nobody else in all the world can change a person's life like that. Now the problem is this. God has a way of seeing things unlike the way the world sees things. You remember when Jesus was in the temple in Jerusalem? Do you remember that when he went to the temple in Jerusalem and there was a fertile old widow that came around? You remember that? You remember that? And the rich man came in and they gave out of their abundance. And the Lord of creation, the sovereign Savior of mankind, was not impressed by the rich man. But little old widow, I don't know what she looked like when she bent over. I don't know. I do know that she was a widow. She had sorrow in her heart. And she didn't have much of this worldly goods. But this little widow made her way down to the offering table, and she laid in all that she had, which was two of the smallest of the Roman coins, less than one of our pennies. And Jesus looked at it, and he didn't say if she gave as much as a rich man. she gave as much as one of them or two of them or another of them. No, Jesus said she gave more than they all gave. Put it all in the calculator and add it all up, brother. She outgave the whole city of Jerusalem. You know why? Because she gave from her heart and she gave all that she had. The Lord sees things different. We look at folks and say, boy, how successful they are. I'm going to tell you something. There's a little bit of danger in climbing the ladder of success if you leave Jesus out. You know why? Because when you get to the top of the ladder, you're going to find out the ladder's been leaning against the wrong building. Maybe I should say that when you get in the elevator to take your last ride with all you've got things of this world, you're going in the wrong direction. You're going down. You ain't going up. This same Jesus, which is so taken up from you, shall so come back down. Heaven is described as up, and hell is described from beneath. God created the hell for the devil and his angels, and never intended for mankind to go there, but man chooses to go there. Paul was a great success. The world would say, boy, he's a total failure. He ends up his life in jail, some kind of preacher. You could cut his head off, but you couldn't hit him off. For me to live is Christ, he says, and to die is gain. But the subject on my heart this morning, delivered to you, is this. A threefold secret of a successful life based on the personal testimony of the Apostle Paul. Look at the 13th verse again. Brethren, I count myself... Count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. What's the secret is it said? Number one, he had a wholehearted dedication and consecration to the task that was at hand. This one thing I do. He didn't say I do lots of things. He said I do this one thing that I do. A rich man was once asked, what's the key to your success for riches? He said, I put all my eggs in one basket and I watch it closely. Watch it closely. Edison, he consecrated his life, dedicated his life to developing electricity and harnessing the electricity, and we have light bulbs today because of that guy's one-hearted devotion to the task that was at hand. How many of you ever flown an airplane? A bunch of you have. Somebody had been scared of it. I never will forget, we were going to the police. I think it was the second year I had a gentleman sitting beside me. I'm going to tell you it was Marty. Anyway, he was scared that he'd never flown before. I was trying to be as much help to him as I could. When the plane took off and we smoothed out and the wheels came under, and clunk, he said, one day, I don't know, I hope the wheels didn't fall off. And we got halfway there to New Orleans, and they don't do this now. They don't serve you. Didn't the last flight I took, they didn't serve you a meal, but they served him a meal. He didn't feel like eating. I said, you're not hungry. I'll eat that for you. You know, I was trying to eat them all I could. You know why we got airplanes? Because there were guys like the Wright brothers who devoted their lives to mastering the secrets of the air. And Jesus put it like this in Matthew 6:24, no man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and you cannot serve man. Put Jesus in the top of your list, dear friend. He has an audible plan for your life. You say, where's that going to take you? It doesn't matter. The safest place in all the world is the center of God's will. Where that's at, whether God leads you to an occupation in a factory or a service station or behind the counter in a taking groceries out or putting groceries on the stairs. on the shelf. It don't matter where God chooses for you in life. He can use you where you are with what you have, but you got to be willing to be used of God. The Apostle Paul was. Now, when it comes to the matter of salvation, Jeremiah 29:13 says, "You shall seek me and find me when you search for me with your whole heart." Whatever you go at, put your heart into it. Right? Put your heart into it. And especially when it comes to this matter of having Jesus as your Savior and your Lord, put your heart into it. Put Jesus first. Search for the Lord with your whole heart. And then when it comes to worship, and certainly the Lord do the same thing, folks. Put your whole heart into it. Verse 13 again, Philippians 3:13. "Brethren, I count not myself to be apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward those things which are before." Step number one, this one thing I do. Step number two, Paul says, forgetting those things which are behind. I know the Bible says, remember, 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 but there's also some times when the Bible says, forget, forget, forget. And when you get to my age, that forgetting part won't be no problem at all. That's come automatically. You know, I've been over once in a while to tie the shoes. And I ask myself, do I need to do anything else while I'm down here? You know? Can't remember. Can't remember. What do you need to forget? You need to forget your blunders. Ever had any blunders in life? If you've done anything at the moment, I mean, I don't for the spur of the moment you did so, you thought, boy, this is the thing I need to do. And then you realize, sometimes you just go on. You need to forget your losses. Your losses. You don't need to park on your losses. Everybody has a few losses now and then. Let me tell you about this guy. You know, I read this guy, wrote these things down about this guy that lost so much. But he never would park on his losses. I know about this guy, and in 1831, he had a business failure. He went belly up in business. 1831. 1832, he decided he had run for legislature, and he got defeated. 1833, he tried a second business, and it didn't go very well either. He went under. 1836, he had a nervous breakdown. 1838, he defeated. He ran for speaker of a political party and lost that. 1840, he entered the election and lost that. 1843, he ran for Congress and he lost that. He got defeated. 1848, he defeated again and ran a second time for Congress. In 1855, he ran for Senate, lost that race, he got defeated. 1856, he ran for Vice President, got defeated. 1858, he ran for Senate again. Say, man, I'd have given up by then. But he didn't park on his failures. He didn't park on his failures. In 1860, he ran one more time. This time he ran for the top job in the United States of America. He ran for president of the United States of America after all those defeats in 1860 and got elected. His name was Abraham Lincoln. All right. What if he'd given up on the first failure, second failure, third failure, fourth failure, fifth failure, sixth failure, seventh failure, eighth failure, ninth failure, tenth failure, 11th failure? What do you quit trying when you make there somewhere? The history of these United States would certainly be a lot different than it is today. Sometimes it's good just to forget the failures of our past. Sometimes we need to forget our successes. There are times, certainly, to forget our sorrow. Our sorrow. sorry as a clean wound, sin as a dirty wound, it never heals. On the blood of Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of God can heal your sin. But sorrow is a clean wound, and with time, it begins to heal. In 2 Corinthians 4:17, the Apostle Paul writes this. He tells us, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far exceeding eternal weight of glory. Sorrows are really for a fleeting, for a moment. You say, boy, you don't know what I went through. That's right. I don't know what you went through. You went through. But I can tell you this. What God has prepared for you will not be limited by time. It will be for eternity. And when we get into eternity, there's no sin. There's no sorrow. There's no death. There's no pain. There's no suffering. There's no sickness. There's not even any crying. There are times when we need to pick up and move on with their lives. Romans 8:28, all things work together for good to them that love God. But those who are called according to his purpose. Point number three. This one thing I do. Philippians 3:13. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth to those things which are before. Number three, I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. He presses forward. Now, this is not the last thing that he wrote. Not the last thing that he wrote. I mean, you say he wrote this from the prison, that's right. But let me tell you something else he wrote. Let me give you his personal testimony that comes from the book of 2 Timothy 4. Verses 6, 7, and 8. He writes for his young son in the ministry on that same prison cell. And this is how he summed his life all up. He said, I am now ready to be offered. And the time of my departure is at hand. I fought a good fight. I finished my course. I've kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but to all them that love his appearing. What a man of God. I've fought a good fight, finished my course, kept the faith. There's laid up a crown of righteousness which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me at that day, not to me only, not to me only, not just to Paul, but to all of them that what? That love his appearing. Is there a special reward at the end of life for those that love the appearing of the Lord? The unsaved don't love the appearing of the Lord. It means final judgment for them. And completed eternal punishment for them. But for those who are saved and know Jesus, we long for the Lord to return. Boy, I'm ready to get out of this old world. I'm ready to leave here. I'm in no hurry, but I'm ready. I'm not going to hasten it up. But I'm going to pray for the hastening of the Lord's return. I love his appearing. Now when that happens, if you get left behind, you can have this whole world. You can have this whole world and everything in it, but you ain't going to be able to rest it. I hear folks say once in a while, I don't know what's coming. They go, well, honey, you're going to get it. You ain't going to like it. It ain't going to be like Walmart. You can't carry it back. It'll be too late. It's eternal. How close are we to the Lord's appearing? I don't know. I'm not on the program committee. I'm on the welcoming committee. There's not an angel in heaven knows the time of the hour when the Lord's coming back. I just know this. I'm ready whenever it happens.
Amen. Now my question for you is, are you ready? Are you saved or lost? Are you ready? Jesus came right now, and the rapture took place right now. Would you rise up with us to meet the Lord in the air, to forever be with the Lord? Or would you be left behind in this world of suffering and sorrow and torment and tribulation, great tribulations, 10 years of it? Are you ready?
Yes,
Lord, we have a tendency to measure success by the world, but worldly standards are no measure of success, because the world's going to pass away. It's going to be consumed, a consuming fire. It's going to be a new heaven, a new earth, a great world of righteousness. But Lord, we know that you measure success by what we do with Jesus, which is called the Christ. And whether we're devoted to him, whether he is the source of our life and the strength of our life. Lord, it may be somebody here in this sanctuary today that doesn't know Jesus as their Savior. I pray that today they'll come to Jesus Christ, receive him in the forgiveness of their sins and the salvation of their soul. There may be somebody watching online. It may be on this Sunday, 2021, or it may be on some weekday, in some point in time between now and when the Lord returns. God, I pray that you'd work on every heart. We know that your salvation, your death is for every person. You died for the sins of the world. Every person can receive God's greatest gift of all time, the gift of his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. You're the one and only Savior. So we pray to move upon our hearts right now and continue to move until the Holy Spirit is withdrawn from this old world, and the saints are removed from this old world. We pray that this service will bring forth an abundant harvest of souls in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together. Right inside the flabby cover, the way for some copy of God's Word and show you how plain and simple, easy and wonderful that salvation is. It's God's gift. It comes by grace. Comes by grace. Free for the asking. God made it simple. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not yourselves. It is a gift of God. It's not a work.
getting in too much. I got time to pray. God's waiting on me. Don't be in a hurry to leave this world unprepared to meet God. And with that thought, you're just good.
Sounds good.